to write in your thoughts and ideas and things that you agree with or disagree with on the presentation you're going to get today. If you don't get it in by the 20th or 25th, 20th, the 20th,
okay, this month,
three days from now, if you're not postmarked or your email is whatever, it's easy. They'll give you information on how to do it today. All right. Later, after the proposal process, there's another process. If you didn't respond on the first one, you don't have a say in the second one at all. Okay. Please keep that in mind when they're talking to us today.
Dan, that's not quite true. So you can comment at any time during the
Put it out at the meeting. So I heard. It was the folks from that organization.
Yeah, I'll cover it, though.
He'll cover that, okay. It's just important, okay? All right, I want to turn it over to Brian. Right. Brian Allen, he's going to run the meeting today. He'll introduce everybody else, and we'll go from there.
Thank you. I'm Brian Harris, the Public Affairs Officer on the FAD National Forest. So, yeah, we'll run through the presentation that we have here. Now, with Cascade and Boise and McCall, we had a couple different players here, so we might stump through a little bit of this, but... the first part of this presentation is actually Keith Lannan did, our forest supervisor. I'm going to cover him for that. And then Jake wasn't with us. Anthony Botello was with us, but Piper got no excuse. So, right. So before we jump into it, I want to give you a quick little update on the fire that we've got going on here. So it's the Missouri fire is what we're calling that. It's about 600 acres right now. It ignited Friday night. We picked it up Saturday morning about 10 o'clock. And we're going full suppression on this fire. Really, the reason being, because where it's sitting up there, it could have the potential to come off down there and head towards Edwardsburg and stuff. And we sure don't want that to take place. We've got about 125 people on it right now. Four helicopters. We were running the single engineer tankers on it yesterday. And it managed to get away from us on initial attack. So we are bringing in an incident management team, a Pipe 2 team. Right now, we're believing that they're going to be at Cox Ranch is where they're going to set up, so it shouldn't impact Johnson Creek airstrip or anything like that. We'll be at this for a little while, so hopefully we'll catch it here and it won't get too much bigger. Any questions about the fire?
Any road closures up there yet?
Not at this point. If we're at Cox Ranch, there's going to be a lot of traffic going down the back bay here and stuff.
What did you say it's called?
Missouri. Missouri fire.
Is it on the Missouri Ridge, or is there some better location?
It's up in there. Let's see.
So it's on the base above Profile Creek, downstream of Missouri Creek, but it's moving up into the Missouri Ridge Country. That's kind of the way it's wanted.
Okay.
And is there any chance they can water the Stibnite Road a little bit?
With all that traffic coming through here.
Yeah. Okay. Great. Yeah. Thank you. Because we're down below it there.
Any other questions about the fire? All right, we'll jump into this then. Let's see. Is there anything I was supposed to say beforehand? Question and answers. We welcome them, actually. So we could get through the presentation and do question and answer after that. That's probably a better way to do it, because probably a lot of questions can be answered in this stuff, too. The way we're set up is all these boards around here are just kind of informational. After we do the presentation, spend some time looking at the boards. Three of us will be here to answer questions at the boards as well, too. If you've got your cell phones with you, take a picture of that board, because a lot of information's on there, too. And really take a picture of this board right here, and that's the how to comment board. So everything is right there for you. Good information, several different ways to do it. We'll talk about that a little bit, too. So let's jump into this slideshow. All right, my name's Hester. Well, you guys know. A little bit of mine has been going on over the years out there. So starting in the late 1800s, various smaller mining activities, but of course through the late 1930s, 1940s, and into the 1950s through the Korean War conflict, lots of operations of smart mining going on up there. Just the other day, I found some old news articles from 1952 when they first started talking about shutting down the mine up here. So so when mining is proposed to the National Forest, we have to follow, of course, federal regulations and laws. So the mining laws that pertain to us right now are the 1872 mining law and the Mining and Mineral Policy Act of 1970. So what those pretty much say is that a private entity can mine on public lands, and that's really what pushes us into the next stage of what we have to do. On Forest Service regulations is our CFR 36228 subpart A, which essentially directs us in how we go through the process of getting a private entity to be allowed to do mining on public lands. The things that we've got to do, Linus Gold has submitted a plan of operation to us, and we have to respond to that plan. We have to evaluate that plan, consider all the requirements as far as trying to minimize the adverse effects to the extent feasible anyway. And that's probably a key part of that, to the extent feasible. Okay. Consider the requirements, we already did that, comply with all the applicable laws and regulations, provide for reclamation. And of course, follow the National Environmental Policy Act. Which is our NEPA process. You guys are probably somewhat familiar with that, with various different other projects that we've got going on. Now, this slide right here is really oversimplified, but it's just the basics. You know, the plan of operation was submitted. We responded to it. It was submitted to us in September, and we responded to it in October.
We determined it.
Yeah. And then that put us into the environmental impact statement. Development is where we're at right now. After we go through this process, which we estimate to be about a 2-year next spring, we'll get into the record of decision is published within that 2-year time frame as well, too. And then mining can start, but it's not quite that simple. Of course, there's a whole bunch of other players that come in with all the permits and clearances. State agencies, other federal agencies such as Corps of Engineer, Environmental Protection Agency, and a whole bunch of cooperating agencies. So right now, I mentioned those top two right there, the EPA and the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, but also on the state side, cooperating agencies are Idaho Department of Lands, Idaho Department of Environmental Quality, the Governor's Office on Energy and Mineral Resources, which is somewhat new, and of course, Valley County. Gordon showed up. He was at the other various meetings that we had. So a cooperating agency is an entity that joins with us in the preparation of the EIS. They provide input. They can also pull input out. We've got those six right now. Potentially, there could be more that are joining us. But the end state is there as the required permits. And they're not always limited to the Clean Water Act and the Section 404 permit, but there's just a whole bunch. National Pollutant Discharge Elimination System, NPDES, the 402 permit, which is a ton of stuff that's got to take place. Once we're finished with the EIS process, that's when all the permitting comes in. There's a lot of the mitigation aspects that are worked in through the EIS, but also as we get into permitting as well. Okay, just a little bit more information about the NEPA timeline. We're right there in that first one where I've got the little green arrow that says this is where we are right now. That's a 45-day public scoping period. The next one that jumps over there, those three that stand out and have that tan color right there, you do actually have two opportunities. So as was mentioned, the first one ends here in 3 days on July 20th. But another one comes up too, and that's once we produce and publish the draft EIS. And you can look at it at that point and make comment at that point, too. Those two, the period we're in right now and the next one that's coming up, those are the two times that you really want to get your information in there so you have what is referred to as standing for an
approve a plan of operations for mining. But we do have to determine whether there's reasonable changes or additions to that plan before the plan is approved. This is a lot of words, but basically the proposed action is to get this plan approved. The other thing, so the Forest Service has to approve the portions of the plan that are on National Forest System lands. The EPA would also utilize our NEPA process as a cooperator to make a decision, a determination and a decision on that NPDES permit. So that's basically a permit to discharge to waters of the United States. Then the Army Corps of Engineers would also have to make a permitting decision, and they'll utilize the NEPA for that, for that 404 permit, which is actually to place fill in waters of the United States.
Can I make a statement about that?
But one of the reasons why the Forest Service has to be involved in approving this, part of their mission statement is that they manage the mining resources in the forest and the grasslands. So that's why the Forest Service is right in the middle of it all and has to start the process.
Okay. Before you jump up again, you did mention a lot of words there, but there are, those words are printed on the boards too. So again, if you want to snap a picture of it. Now everything that you see right here is actually posted online too. So we have a specific project website where this entire presentation is posted there as well, along with all the other documents that are being produced for the project too.
So yeah, the other decisions that the forest might have to make or will have to make, aside from just the portions of the mining that'll happen on forest, we may have to do some project-specific forest plan amendments, because there are certain standards in the forest plan that the proposal doesn't quite conform with, and we have the authority to do that, but that will be disclosed in the analysis. So this is super simplified. Midas proposes to mine over a period of 20 to 20 plus years by the time you factor in all the reclamation at the end of the project and monitoring post project, but it's this is simplified to four stages, but a lot of it will be happening kind of concurrently. So they plan to do the initial redevelopment of the site and construction for the first 2 to 3 years, mining ore processing 12 to 15 years, full on mining operation, another couple of 3 years to do closure reclamation, and then monitoring, which can go on for an extended period of time based on needs. And a lot of this stuff will happen concurrently, particularly some of the reclamation of the legacy mining impacts and mitigations for the project will kind of be ongoing throughout the project. And Midas is planning to, they've made some determinations on what's out there in the ground. They expect to produce two products that will be hauled off site for further processing, and those are gold, silver doré bars that will come out of their process plant, as well as antimony concentrates, and that will have some component of silver as well. And those are shipped contained there. It's like a containerized powder that will be shipped. And antimony has got a lot of applications, military, technological, and other applications like fire retardant. Through internal Forest Service scoping and also interagency scoping, we've come up with a whole bunch of physical, biological, and social resources that we need to address through the analysis. And what we're really looking for from the public, from you folks, is questions, comments that will help us focus this stuff down, narrow it down to truly significant issues that might drive the development of alternatives to the plan, so long as they're reasonable. The other thing that Brian mentioned, we have ride for is reclamation. And so reclamation is basically doing the best you can to put things back to a functional state after the mining operation. Of course, mining, you know, has a lot of impacts on the surface, and we just have to do the best we can to make that back into a functioning ecosystem. The other thing that we have to do too, and it's not a NEPA process, an administrative process, is the bonding for reclamation. We actually have to do a cost estimate of the cost to the government to do all of the reclamation. And then through that process, which we'll do in conjunction with a lot of the other agencies, particularly Idaho Department of Lands, because a lot of the operation is actually private land, and Department of Lands has primacy over reclamation in the state of Idaho, regardless of land ownership. But we'll work with all the other agencies to come up with that realistic cost estimate, and then get the financial assurances, and those can be all different kinds of financial instruments, from Midas Gold to ensure that reclamation is going to get done. And then those monies can be released as Midas completes that. That can be released in stages. The amounts can be adjusted depending on costing if something changes. So that's kind of reclamation bonding in a nutshell. So. Operations and support infrastructure. One of those on-site pieces of infrastructure is going to be actually what they're calling the Stibnite Lodge. It will be on-site housing with the idea that the workforce will be there kind of on a two-week-on, two-week-off shift. That'll minimize, in and out daily traffic. And it's a full-on, I guess you'd call it kind of almost like a housing complex with, recreation facilities, waste management, kind of a nice hotel style with, quarters and food and the whole nine yards.
Are there going to be schools and hospitals there?
I'm sure they're going to have probably a pretty elaborate, EMS, internal kind of response system, but I don't believe
that. I would say, as opposed to the way mining was done in the 30s, 40s, and 50s, their intent is not to put a company town out there. So as far as schools and stuff, the answer would be no. The intent would be that workers would live in Cascade and McCall, or they could just travel. They could be workers from Boise that just come up for that two-week time frame. They come out there and stay in the lodge, and they're off for 2 weeks, and they go back. So no, not a company account like I've seen in the past.
Okay.
Okay, I'm gonna turn it over to Jake.
Okay, yeah. Hopefully it's not too awkward. We're gonna bounce around a little bit. So good morning, I'm Jake Strohmeyer, the district ranger in Cascade for the Boise National Forest. As Brian mentioned, parts of this project are on the pad, parts of it are on the Boise. The mining is all on the pad, as over in Stibnite, but there is quite a bit of stuff, roads, power lines, and some other things that are occurring on the Boise National Forest. So I'll try to cover those. So one of those activities that is proposed to occur is the construction of a road maintenance facility, either at the Landmark Guard Station or somewhere very near the Landmark Guard Station. The idea there is that it would be a place to have equipment sheds, have sanding, plowing equipment, all that sort of stuff there for the winter maintenance of the road, because that is one of the one of the parts of the proposal is that the haul route would be a 12-month a year road, and so lots of snow plowing, lots of need to sand, that sort of thing. So a lot of details that haven't been figured out there, but basically some sort of something like you can picture an ITD shop along the highway out there that's got equipment parked there. There may be some possibility of working with Midas to use some of the housing at Landmark during the winter time, that sort of thing as well. But some things we need to figure out there as well. It's actually in a pretty good spot that's proposed right now. It's actually on gravel pit. It's on the far south end of the Landmark site. It's kind of out of view, actually, of the Landmark station itself. So, access to the site. The proposal right now is to use the Warm Lake Highway from Cascade to Landmark, so the existing Warm Lake Road without, you know, any real improvements to that. And then from there, to take off on the existing Burnlog Road, it would be a major upgrade to the existing Burnlog Road, approximately 20-foot wide roadway, you know, with shoulders, ditches, all that, so probably about a 26-foot wide road prism. So using that road for, I can't remember all the mileage, but it's close to 20-some miles out the existing Burnlog Road, upgrading that and rerouting it at a few places. From the end of the Burnlog Road, the route takes off, moves over, drops down off into Trapper Creek, Trapper Flats country, switchbacks around one of the knobs out there, drops into Reardon Creek, and this is all new construction at this point in time, drops off into Reardon Creek, and then comes up out of Reardon Creek, below Meadow Creek Bridge on that hillside, until it ties into the Meadow Creek Bridge about 2 miles, 2 miles south of the lookout. At that point in time, use a small portion of the existing Meadow Creek Bridge Road, and then the road would dive off all new construction down off into the headwaters of the East Fork, and then down off into the site along the existing road. Proposal right now is that road would be open to public traffic and would allow continued access out to the Thunder Mountain country. And as I think probably you're all aware, is that the reason, and so as part of this, is that the Yellow Pine Pit itself, which Piper will go over some of the details of this later, actually takes in where the existing road up through the site is right now. And so the proposal is that road would be closed at some point, probably up near Sugar Creek, and then there wouldn't be any public access through the mine site. So the alternative public access to get beyond Stibnite out to Thunder Mountain would be through the Burnlog Road. Is there a slide that talks about the alternatives public access anywhere?
No, Jake, why don't you cover that right now? I think it's kind of on that map.
Okay. Yeah, and so as part of the proposal as well is, in order to kind of try to keep some public motorized access from the Yellow Pine area without having to go all the way back up the Landmark and out the Burnlog, is they're looking at using the Horse Heaven Road, basically the power line road that goes up to the top, and then constructing a new motorized trail along the top of the ridge out to Meadow Creek Lookout, and then connecting into the new upgraded road, and then off onto the existing Meadow Creek. Well, it could be a whole bunch of different things. So it could be something that's a motor vehicle. Well, it can be, but to be specific to this project, the idea is it would be basically a jeep truck. That's what the proposal is right now. So
open to
all vehicles, but it's not going to be like a, you know, something you're going to drive a car up. It'd be something you need a high clearance for the right vehicle.
No horse trailers.
Right.
Who would make a horse trailer?
So as far as the maintenance goes on that, that's undetermined at this point in time. You know, at the proposal stage, it's something that, you know, it's part of Midas's plan. So the assumption is it'd be something that Midas would help construct and maintain throughout the life of the project, and that we'd have to, you know, the proposal is going to have to, the decision is going to have to decide what happens to all this stuff when it's done. Currently, Midas's plan, the whole upgraded Burnlog Road and all that stuff would be the new construction would be decommissioned, and then the existing roads would be restored, you know, somewhat back to their previous state at the end of the project, and then the road would be reconstructed back through the site, so things would go back to pretty much the existing condition at the end of the project. Diana?
Do they have an alternative plan if they're going to make that a jeep road for all the people who use it as a hiking trail and horseback access. To my mind, that would eliminate a lot of recreational opportunities for the people from the airstrip, and it would create quite a congestion in terms of the people who live along Johnson Creek and face that face.
There's nothing in the proposal right now, Dan. That'd be an awesome comment to make. Help drive the alternative.
Questions are really good comments.
Yeah.
No. Or folks that are possibly working for Midas and wanting to live here in town, is there going to be access for them to travel from here directly up East Fork? Are they going to have to do the burnt log route, go all the way back?
Yeah, so that's a question I have too, Matt, and I've never really gotten an answer on that. There isn't anything specifically in the proposal that talks about being able to, you know, continue up and then some way to get to the mine site through an annual mine.
I've heard Rocky say a couple times that no, you won't be able to commute from Yellow Pine to work.
Right now, there's nothing in the plan that says you'll be able to do that.
Yeah. Not going that direction.
Yeah, right.
You should
not
very
far to go up. And,
right.
Right.
Correct.
Thank you.
You guys know that the road as it exists right now goes right by the Yellow Pine pit. You know, when they open that back up, I mean, that'll definitely take the road.
Brian, it seems that all this reconstruction, it's not that far to go around the Yellow Pine pit. It would seem reasonable to look at that alternative.
Yes.
I guess I asked the question, why wasn't that looked at? It's not that far. I mean, you're only talking a couple of miles.
Yeah, you know, Marilyn, I like to say it's not in their plan right now, but that's a great comment.
Yeah.
You know, and really, guys, all these things that you're coming up with are great comments. They really are. The plan is what it is right now. As we go through the EIS and understand all these impacts, that's when we develop different alternatives that could then steer their plan of operations in a little bit of a different direction. Mm-hmm. So these are great comments to get in.
Well, and I guess what is hard for us, being from the outside, is we don't know the impact that it would have on mining activity or the project site. If we knew a little better, it was a little more obvious, it might make more sense, but to me right now, doesn't seem reasonable and doesn't seem to make sense.
So I will mention that Midas did include an appendix to their plan that did go through kind of an alternatives analysis. And I don't know if exactly what you guys are talking about was one of those alternatives, but it does kind of get into some of these questions. But we can certainly revisit those in our alternatives analysis through the NEPA process. And of course add more potential.
And a loop road to the north of the pit. Come out, you know, near the Meadow Creek area where you can cross across the road with the traffic light or a stop sign.
Well, and, you know, you guys can even draw a map and that is a comment.
Big question I have is back in the 1990s, we've already had this discussion. The Forest Service wanted to close the road. And Congresswoman Helen Chenoweth came to the mine, as did Senator Lee Heinrich, a few others, Mr. Babbitt. But the agreement that was reached with the Forest Service was that was a public easement through there and that you guys would never close that road ever again. Similar situation with Jim Nelson, because I got that directly from him, was part of the agreement for selling private land at Thunder Mountain was you guys had to leave existing access to Thunder Mountain from here. What are you guys doing to honor that agreement?
So the access would still be through the burnt log road. There'd still be access out to Thunder Mountain. But to clarify something, Scott, is that the piece of the road that would be impacted by Midas's mining activities is on private land. The county holds the easement across that. And so it's not a Forest Service decision on whether or not that road gets closed or not by the mining impacts. That's something that, you know, between Midas and Valley County, they're going to have to decide, because the Forest Service does not have an easement through that piece of private property.
Okay, another question, and unfortunately that guy couldn't make it here, but I have talked to landowner at Cinnabar, and he's proposed a possible access route around through Cinnabar across his private land. I have an email that he might be willing to grant an easement. Is that an alternative you guys would consider?
Hey, Jake.
Can you write one letter